வணக்கம். Yes, electrical burns are a major problem in different phases. They are fatal sometimes to the life and sometimes to the limb. And if not fatal, they lead to a lot of morbidities and sequelae that are very difficult to correct. But the best part is, most of these morbidities that ensue are totally preventable. Well-planned surgical management along with religious physiotherapy can prevent these problems. And even when they do present, a meticulous planning followed by a well-executed surgery can restore most of the function. We shall be seeing a very simple method of surgical management of the acute problem and the method of management of the sequelae. Before we make an attempt to learn about the effect of electric current on the hand, we need to first understand the basics of electrical burns and the physics of electricity. As medical professionals, there are five things about the basic electric current that we need to know in relation to the injury that it can cause. They are voltage, the type of current, whether alternating current or direct current, the amperage of the current, and two factors involving the human body, that is the resistance of the skin and the pathway that the current takes through the body. If the voltage of the current is less than 1000 volts, it is known as a low voltage burn. It is not enough to cause tissue damage along its path except at the contact side, and this too depends on the contact time. As you can see in the right palm of this patient who has sustained a low voltage burn on the palm and the tip of the ring finger. On the other hand, a high voltage burn has a voltage of more than 1000 volts, and the damage that it causes runs along its course throughout the body. As far as the type of current is concerned, there are two types basically. One is the alternating current and the other is the direct current. The alternating current is about 4 to 5 times more dangerous than the direct current because it causes more severe muscular contractions, and it also stimulates sweating, which lowers the skin resistance and leads to breakdown of the skin. 60 cycles or hertz is the most harmful range. There is what is known as a let-go current. It is about 22 milliamperes in alternating current and 88 milliamperes in direct current. The third important aspect of the electrical current is the amperage. When the current passes through the body, it can cause different types of sensation according to the difference in the amperage. The first is the tingle sensation that we normally perceive when our fingers come into contact with a household electrical appliance. This tingle sensation occurs at about 0.25 to 0.5 milliamperes for an adult female and between 0.5 to 1 milliampere for an adult male. The next higher sensation is known as the uncomfortable sensation when the current is over 1 to 2 milliamperes in either sex. The third parameter to remember is what is known as the maximum let-go level. That is, up to a certain level of amperage of the current, the person who has touched the electrical source will be able to take his hand off. Above a certain level, which is about 9 milliamperes for females and 15 milliamperes for males, the person will not be able to take his hand away because they lose control of their muscles and the electricity causes the muscles to contract till the current source is removed. Above the maximum let-go level, up to about 100 milliamperes, severe pain, respiratory arrest, and severe muscular contractions can occur, and death is even possible. When the amperage is more than 100 milliamperes, ventricular fibrillation can occur and death is very likely. Though the characteristics of the electric current that strikes the body are important, the characteristics of the body and skin are also very important. The resistance of the skin becomes progressively lesser as the skin becomes moist or it is breached. Dry skin has a resistance of about 500,000 ohms per square centimeter. If the skin is moist, the resistance is much lower, only about 1000 ohms per square centimeter, whereas when the skin is breached and there is an ulcer or a breakdown of the skin, the resistance comes to barely 500 ohms per square centimeter. When the resistance is less, the amount of current entering the body is more. We also need to remember that the heat generated is proportional to the square of the current that enters the body and the resistance. The current having entered the body can take any pathway. If it runs from the finger only to the elbow, what the patient perceives is only a painful shock. But if the current passes from the hand to foot or through the chest from one hand to the other, it may prove fatal. Summarizing, when we consider the type of the current, whether AC or DC, the AC or alternating current is worse. As far as the voltage is concerned, high voltage, that is more than 500 volts, is bad. And if the amperage is more than the let go current, it is bad. Moist or breached skin is bad, as it has very little resistance to the electrical flow. And the pathway of current from the hand to hand or the hand to foot have very bad prognosis. There are four main types of burns that can be caused by the electrical injury in the hand: contact burns, arc burns, flash burns, and flame burns. The contact burn is of two types: the entry wound, where the electrical current enters the body, and the exit wound, where the electrical current exits from the body to the ground. The entry wounds are characteristically on the hands. They are charred, centrally depressed areas of necrosis, leathery in appearance, with a black metallic coating on the skin from the electroplating of the skin surface. Whereas the exit wounds, which are also a type of contact burns, are more likely to explode as the charge exits from the body, and these are usually found on the feet. The second type of burn is the arc burn. There is no direct contact of this burn area with the electrical source. The electrical energy travels from an area of high resistance to an area of low resistance, which is usually the axilla or the elbow or the wrist, where the moist skin has a lower resistance and allows the current to pass in easier. The circuit is completed when the air particles are ionized. In such a situation, there is a very high amount of heat and there is also a blast of pressure from the arc. You can see here that the primary electrical current entering the hand has charged the entire hand, but then the current has passed over the ionized air and over the area of intact and normal skin to reach the elbow, where it causes an arc burn. The third type of burn that can be caused by an electrical injury is the flash burn. This is usually because of the flash that occurs from the electrical source causing the injury. This burn is usually a superficial burn, which has a filigree appearance, and usually these wounds heal on their own. And lastly, even a flame burn can be caused in an electrical injury, for example, when the clothes catch fire and cause burns. We shall now see how the different types of burns manifest in a patient with an electrical injury involving the upper limb. The contact burns, that is, the entry wounds in the fingers and thumb, the arc burns involving the wrist, the elbow, and the axilla, the flame burns involving the intermediate segment of the forearm, and the destruction that is caused in each type of burn. In the contact burn, you will note the gangrene of the little finger. In the arc burns, especially at the wrist and the elbow, we would note the amount of destruction of the muscles and soft tissues. Whereas in the area of the flame burn, there is not much of destruction of the underlying tissues. Having learnt the basics about the electrical current that can cause so much damage in the human body, we shall now see the management. The management, of course, has two main priorities. The first is preservation of life, and the second is the management of the problem in the limb. The management of electrical burns consists of managing the first priority, that is the life. This can be done by taking care of four important factors: the development of cardiac arrhythmias, myoglobinuria, which could be direct or indirect, renal failure, and associated injuries to the head, spine, chest, or abdomen. At the same time, we also need to prevent sequelae of loss of limb and loss of function, and also manage the sequelae of loss when they occur. The five commonest problems we are going to encounter are the development of compartment syndrome, development of gangrene, raw areas that develop, contractures that may form, and the loss of function. We will deal with these five situations individually under the headings of cause, the problem, the diagnosis, the treatment, and the follow-up. The compartment syndrome is one of the commonest problems in electrical burns. The normal intracompartmental pressure in the forearm is about 8 to 10 millimeters of mercury. When it goes more than 30 millimeters of mercury, it causes the compartment syndrome. And when this occurs, it leads to further destruction of muscle and rhabdomyolysis, leading to acute renal shutdown. It can shut down the distal circulation, leading to gangrene. It will compromise the blood supply of the nerves, leading to paralysis and loss of function, and may compromise the circulation to the skin too, leading to necrosis. The reason for the development of this compartment syndrome starts with the passage of electric current in the forearm. This causes damage to the muscle bulk in the forearm. These damaged muscles swell up and cause an increase in the pressure of the tight osteofacial compartment of the forearm. This increased pressure further compromises the muscle blood flow, leading to more muscle necrosis. And this muscle damage initiates a vicious cycle. The classical clinical features of the compartment syndrome in the upper limb are tense brawny edema of the forearm and pain on passive stretch of fingers. It is not advisable to wait for the classic description of 5 P's: pain, pallor, pulselessness, paresthesia, and paralysis. By the time these symptoms develop, the compartment syndrome would have caused extensive damage. The diagnosis of compartment syndrome can be made by using pressure measurement gauge, but by far the best parameter of diagnosis of compartment syndrome are clinical awareness, a clinical suspicion of the problem occurring, and a thorough clinical examination. When in doubt, it is better to release the suspected increased compartmental pressure. The incision for the release of the compartmental pressure extends from the palm along the thenar crease, across the wrist at an angle, and across the entire forearm up to the distal level of the arm. This is to make sure that the entire forearm is decompressed. The procedure consists of incising the skin, the deep fascia, and once the deep fascia is incised, the muscle prolapses. This deep fascia is incised starting from the distal forearm up to the distal level of the arm. The incision on the palmar surface must go through the carpal tunnel and release the carpal tunnel also. If possible, the Gans canal also must be released. After this deep fascia is opened, the muscles are individually separated and the median and ulnar nerves should be visualized and made sure that there is no compression anywhere distal to the elbow. This release must be done under tourniquet control, and after the adequate release has been obtained, the tourniquet must be released, absolute hemostasis achieved, and sterile dressings done. The compartment has been decompressed, but skin cover is absolutely important, and skin cover in the form of skin graft must be done within 48 hours. If tendons are exposed, as is common in electrical burns, the other areas can be covered with a skin graft and flap cover planned for the exposed areas. This needs to be done latest by 2 weeks. And once the skin graft or flap cover has been done, the work is not over, because the damaged flexors are going to start pulling the fingers. Stretching exercises and flexion exercises, that is mobilization, and stretching splints, immobilization, should be advised. Mobilization and immobilization form the yin and yang of therapy. The second important sequelae we need to manage in electrical burns is gangrene. Gangrene in electrical burns presents in 3 different ways. The patient may present with gangrene, and this occurs because the hand is charged by the electrical current. The gangrene may set in after compartment syndrome or release of the compartment syndrome, or the gangrene can extend after the amputation. So the gangrene may be caused by damage to the vessel from inside, because the nerves, blood vessels, mucous membranes, and muscles are the best conductors of electricity. When current passes through large vessels at its entrance or exit points, it may cause a pronounced inflammatory reaction and small areas of vascular wall necrosis, which may result in immediate or delayed rupture of the vessel. Current flowing through larger vessels that are located beyond the entrance and exit points of the current may cause mural thrombi, but vessels usually remain patent temporarily. And in smaller vessels, the heat injury results in vessel thrombosis. At the same time, damage to the vessel from outside can come in the form of the compartment syndrome as a result of muscle necrosis or as a result of over-resuscitation effect, otherwise called the fluid creep. As a result of a gangrene, there may be a loss of a functional part like the thumb, loss of length, and problems of rehabilitation. The management of the gangrene comes under four modalities. The first is measures to prevent the gangrene by procedures like fasciotomy and adequate resuscitation. The second modality is to limit the gangrene when it occurs by methods of infection control and again resuscitation. The third modality is to remove the gangrene when it is established. And lastly, measures to reconstruct the lost length and function due to the gangrene. So as in this case, apart from the flap cover given to cover the raw area on the forearm, a flap is given on the stump of the palm to retain the length of the palm. Or as in this patient, an above elbow amputation has been done with a fasciotomy going in for more necrosis and skin closed primarily over the stump. But this skin broke down, and in order to preserve the length of the humerus available, a pedicled latissimus dorsi myocutaneous flap was used. And in conditions where there has been a gangrene of the thumb, loss of the thumb can result in serious loss of function. This can be reconstructed with a vascularized second toe transfer. Next come the inevitable raw areas that develop in electrical burns. They can be due to the contact burn of the skin with the electrical current. They could be due to arc burns, which occur at the wrist, elbow and axilla. They could also occur after skin necrosis due to compartment syndrome, or there could be the fasciotomy wound while decompressing the compartment syndrome. The obvious reconstruction for raw areas are skin grafts or skin flaps. And to help us decide, we have the reconstructive ladder. The first rung of this ladder is the conservative management, indicated for flash burns and superficial flame burns that can occur, and these heal by 3 weeks. The second rung of this ladder, that is primary suturing of the wound, has a very limited role in electrical burns and is indicated only for linear contact burns of the trunk and abdomen. Skin grafting is the next modality that is quite widely used. It is indicated for superficial wounds with no underlying damage to the tendons or nerves, and also for fasciotomy wounds of the forearm. It is important that these wounds, when grafted, must be followed up with splints and graft care. Local flaps like the rotation flaps and transposition flaps are usually indicated for small defects on the upper limb, like this defect for which a rotation flap has been done from the forearm. Regional flaps, on the other hand, are more widely used and indicated for small defects on the fingers, wrist, and for defects on the shoulder and arm. Either skin flaps or myocutaneous flaps can be used as regional flaps. Distant flaps are most widely used for electrical burn raw area reconstruction because the defects are deep and sometimes very large. The options available are the groin flap, the abdominal flap, or the stepladder abdominal flaps. And large single defects on the hand or forearm can be resurfaced with microvascular free flaps. Having discussed the different types of reconstruction that may be needed in patients with electrical burns, we need to consider another important factor, the timing when this reconstruction needs to be done. For post-fasciotomy wounds, the cover should be done by 48 to 72 hours, and there is no problem in this because the fasciotomy wound was created by a surgical maneuver. If there is a deeper damage, the wounds require serial debridement, and it is ideal to wait for a period of 7 to 10 days before definitive flap coverage is planned. This is because there is an ongoing necrosis due to microthrombi caused by the passage of electric current through the small capillaries. Hence, the circulation of the wound bed and the surrounding skin may not be adequate to support a flap cover before this period. There have been different papers describing different ideal timings for reconstruction, but we have seen that the period of 1 week to 10 days is the safest period for flap reconstruction. When the primary management of electrical burn raw areas has not been adequate or the follow-up has been inadequate, we get contractures. So, secondary healing of skin wounds can result in contractures. Inadequate splinting after wound healing can also cause the same contractures, and skin grafting done in children can cause contractures as the growth of the grafts may not keep up with the growth of the children. And as a result of contractures, patients will have a loss of span of the hand and fingers and a loss of function. And the method of reconstruction, as in this patient who had a skin grafting done in early childhood for electrical burn raw area, now presenting with contractures, a release and skin reconstruction with durable skin is the answer. The release has been done and surgical syndactyly created, resurfaced with parambilical flap, and then at a later stage, the surgical syndactyly is released to achieve a stable skin cover and full range of function. But as shown, follow-up surgery may be required and splinting is very essential, as is mobilization. In releasing a contracture, we need to remember 2 points. One, we need to find the axis of the joint that has been contracted and then incise the contracture from one axis to the other, and beyond the point of axis, fishtailing needs to be done. Only then a sustained contracture release can be obtained, whether resurfaced with a skin graft or a skin flap. Apart from the skin problem, there are problems associated with the loss of important underlying structures resulting in loss of function. The difference between flame burns and electrical burns essentially is that in flame burns, there is only a loss of span of movements, that is only a skin contracture. Whereas in electrical burns, there is a loss of span of movements, that is skin contracture, along with loss of function due to loss of tendons and nerves. This is due to the nature of contact burns and arc burns causing third and fourth degree burns. If there is so much of underlying tissue damage in electrical burns, can we compare electrical burns to a trauma where the amount of tissue damage is more? Yes, to a certain extent, but there exist certain differences between the tissue damage in trauma and the tissue damage occurring in electrical burns. In trauma, the loss of structures is defined and immediate reconstruction is possible. Whereas in electrical burns, the loss of structures evolves over a period of time, and immediate reconstruction may actually be detrimental. As current passes in the body, heat is produced proportionate to the tissue resistance. The tissue resistance to the electrical current is most with bone and least with the nerve. Bone, having the greatest resistance, generates more heat as the current passes, resulting in deep periosseous tissue destruction. So as the current enters through the skin breach, it does not generate much heat as it passes through the tissues which do not give much resistance, like the muscles, nerves and vessels, till it reaches the bone. And when it reaches the bone, because of the high resistance of the bone to the electrical current, heat is generated which chars all the tissues around it, especially the tendons and muscles. This is sometimes known as the tip of the iceberg damage, where what you are seeing is only the tip of the iceberg and a very small wound is seen. But under this apparently small wound, there is a very large amount of tissue destruction underneath, which resembles the iceberg. Generally, the loss of underlying structures to the skin, like the tendons, nerves and bones, can cause loss of function. And what is required is a staged reconstruction. This meaning, first replacement of the skin with a good quality skin, and then tendon transfer, grafting or free functional muscle transfer for achieving active movements, nerve grafting or pedicle nerve transfer to get back sensation, and vascularized bone transfer if there has been a loss of bone. This adherent and unstable skin graft will not allow any reconstruction under it, so it is resurfaced with a distal flap. And then under this good quality skin, a tendon grafting is done for the flexor tendons using facial atta graft. In yet another patient, the pedicle nerve transfer described by St. Clair Strange is shown, where the proximal ends of the ulnar nerve and median nerve are sutured together in the first stage. And when there is a bone loss, as seen in this patient due to an electrical burn injury, it is reconstructed with a vascularized fibula transfer. And not forgetting the principles of hand surgery, achieving good results depends on a good therapy and judicious use of mobilization and protective splints. I hope you liked this video. I enjoyed making it. Please click on the shown links to see more about other procedures like the trigger finger release. And do not forget to subscribe to keep connected with the latest in learning hand surgery.